way. Getting back to the black grass, very much a specialist species of woodland edge, and up here we've got this very special woodland, ancient Caledonian forest, but it's on the change, and it's been on the change for thousands of years.
To many, these glorious open views epitomise the Scottish Highlands. What few realise is that this is a landscape largely created by humans, a shadow of what once was and of what could be again.
So, Alison, this is an area that thousands of years ago would have been covered in forest.
Yes, absolutely. We think about 6,000 years ago this would have had peak forest cover. And you can imagine trees stretching all the way up here to 650 metres or even higher. Since that time, Neolithic man came, started chopping the trees down, agricultural animals and so on. And then about 4,500 years ago, the climate also became cooler and wetter, which makes it less suitable for trees such as pine to grow.
As humans, sheep and cattle flourished, so the Caledonian forest shrank to just 1% of its former size. Meanwhile, the extermination of wolves in the mid-18th century meant Scotland's red deer no longer had any natural predators. And as the deer became increasingly valued by sports hunters, their population boomed.
So, Alison, how many red deer do you think there are in Scotland?
Well, the best estimate is that there's about 350,000 red deer now across Scotland. And if you go back to the 1960s, there are about 150,000. So they've increased hugely in that intervening time period.
In parts of Scotland, this means up to 40 red deer per square kilometre. Together with livestock, these can have a huge impact on the forest. Traditionally, landowners fenced off their trees to protect them. But fences are expensive, hard to maintain, and can be a death trap to rare woodland birds like the capercaillie. So to restore a natural balance, the deer population needs to be controlled.
In terms of regenerating a forest, the best guess is that you need to get the numbers below 5 per square kilometre in order to let the trees get away. And some people say you even need to get them below 1 deer per square kilometre.
So that means culling the deer?
Yes, that's right, it does.
Culling is costly and controversial, but in some parts of Scotland, it's already having an effect.
Now, Alison, this area here looks encouraging because there are loads of saplings.
Yes, this is a really fantastic example of what's happening in many areas of Scotland now. Probably about 20 years ago, there was big encouragement of regeneration, recognition of the loss of habitat. And as the deer numbers have come down, in this area, you can see a huge response now from the trees. It's really exciting to see that. It might take about 20 years for them to get above the browsing height of the deer. So if you look at this tree here, the gap between these different whorls represents a year of growth. So if you want to try and age it, it's fairly straightforward for the unbrowsed bits. You can see last year, really good growth, the year before that, down to this whorl, down to that whorl. But then when you come down to here, there's a big gnarly lump of stem there, which is probably where it was repeatedly browsed when the deer numbers were high, and it could have sat at this level even for 10 years or so, not growing at all.
Alison, if we look over here, there are fully grown pine trees. How old are they?
Those would probably be about 200 years plus.
Gee, that really shows the generation gap,
yeah,
then, doesn't it? There's,
yes,
nothing in between these new ones.
Absolutely.
And these 200-year-old,
yeah,
ones.
Yeah, it's a really good example. And I think that's one of the reasons why people started to realise that they needed to do something now, before the forest disappeared altogether. Because once these trees get too old to produce seeds, we would be in real trouble.
The last 20 years have seen an increasing awareness of the importance of the Caledonian forest. Now, with European law encouraging its regeneration, the Scottish landscape looks set to change once again.
You know, it's all about balance, despite the fact that 80% of the deer now living in Scotland live in open areas. They are a forest species. So ideally, the deer need the forest, and in fact, the forests also need the deer, because they help to open the forest out for other highland species. They also help to germinate the forest and spread the seeds. So let's hope that we can get some sort of balance back.
Which is what we need. And if you'd like to find out more about this, there are some links on our website. That's bbc.co.uk/winterwatch. And you can also post your views on a blog there. Take a look at that.
Having fun, yeah?
Are you a waterproof pheasant tonight, or are you? You're a bit of a drowned rat. Look at you.
But it's exciting, isn't it? It's exciting. It can't make its mind up. can we revel in these?
It is beautiful.
Because the whole of this site is full of these lovely lichens. And that's a sign of very, very clear air. It must be pure air for them to grow in profusion like this. There's three different sorts. There's a crusty one that you often see in stones and graveyards. There's also the sort of leafy ones here. And then there are the more sort of tendrily ones. Like
they
that.
Like a sort of snouser's eyebrows, those ones, aren't
they? They are, Chris. Shall we revel in them?
Come on, then.
These are some of the ones that we've filmed here. Look at the beauty of them. And what they actually are, they're a very unusual organism because they're a mixture of fungus and algae that have combined together. And they both help each other out. The fungus provides protection for the algae, and the algae photosynthesizes and provides nutrients for the fungus.
And they are incredibly tough, aren't they?
Shall we swap amazing facts? Shall I do the first one? Okay, in 2005, the Soyuz spaceship took some of this lichen up into space, exposed it to space for 15 days, brought it back, perfectly all right. Your turn.
They are remarkably long-lived. In fact, they're the oldest living organisms that we have on the planet. They think they found some lichens in the Arctic that are 8,600 years old. 8,600 years old. That's what I call ancient.
You can tell these two are lichen.
Oh, dear.
Oh, that was terrible, wasn't it? And we have certainly been enjoying the ancient forest up here in the Kangles, and so we should, because we've learned that there's only 1% of it left in Scotland. But, you know, 6,000 years ago, three-quarters of Britain would have been covered in ancient woodland. But what would it have looked like? Well, it would have been a very different place.
In one corner of southeast England, there's a very special wood. A woodland to visit and enjoy during these short days. Somewhere to let our imagination wander and wonder about the wildlife that lives there. Weak sunlight brings little warmth, and the woodland seems almost lifeless. But beneath the roots, out of sight. Here dormice slumber to escape the cold, resting in true hibernation. They may stay curled up in this coziness for up to 7 months, waiting for the temperatures to rise. Further underground, bigger creatures retreat from winter's grip. Badgers. They don't actually hibernate, but often sleep huddled together to help keep in the warmth. But not everything here sleeps through the long freezing nights. A wood mouse delves amongst the leaf litter under the cover of darkness, looking for seeds and nuts. Its sensitive nose sniffs out food, ears and eyes constantly alert for danger. And it must be cautious, because high above, a tawny owl's huge eyes and keen ears are intently watching and particularly listening. A wood mouse would be a welcome meal in these lean times. As dawn breaks, some of the wood's more unexpected residents stir. Wild boar dig and furrow their way through the sodden ground, looking for roots, bulbs, and anything else they think they can eat. The sun slowly rises. Shadows move silently through this forest. Fallow deer. The autumn rut now over, they stick together in a herd for safety because they sense danger here. They can smell predators. Lynx are waiting, watching. A small deer would make perfect prey. Thick fur keeps out the winter chill. Even the soles of their paws are covered. This lone hunter, about the size of a sheepdog, hasn't been seen in our countryside since Roman times. Now it's only disturbed by the master of the woods, the wolf. By hunting in packs, wolves can even take on the largest prey, red deer. Wolves are top predators, keeping nature in check, ensuring balance. But wolves haven't roamed our land for centuries either. So where is this mythical place? Where is this ancient wild wood, home to historical hunters? It's all we have left. It's a wildlife park, just a dream of our past. But there are people here trying to make this dream come true. Zoos are breeding these animals, and in some cases, releasing them too. Not the big predators, not yet anyway. Some people talk of a forest that will be truly wild again. Wolves, lynx, even bears. Perhaps they could all return. Perhaps this wildwood is more than an echo of our history. Could it be a vision of wild things to come?
Well, it's amazing to think about what would have been here, but how feasible is it to put any of those animals back into the wild?
It's a really interesting question. In a way, it's a legal requirement, because under the EU directive, it's Article 22, the EU directive, I had to write it down to get it right, on conservation, it says this: member states shall study the desirability of reintroducing species that are native to their territory. So the EU want us to try and study at least that possibility.
Well, in fact, they've done it in certain parts of Europe, haven't they? Switzerland, Germany, France have all tried it. And in Switzerland, it's been very successful. I think they started in 1971 with lynx.
71, yeah.
And if you think about it, Switzerland is a highly populated country. I mean, much more densely populated than the Highlands of Scotland. So it is possible. It's being done.
It is being done. So that there are, we can learn from those what's happened in France, Germany and Switzerland. But also, it wouldn't be just like opening a door and letting them out. It'd have to be very carefully considered. And it'd probably be like the foxes we've been watching. They'd have collars, radio collars, so they'd be monitored and managed very, very carefully to make sure that it was working properly. You know, they'd have to be very... very careful, but it's a very interesting possibility.
It's a good debate, isn't it?
It basically is, yeah.
But, you know, now we only really have the small predators left, like these wild cats. Now, this is a wild cat filmed in the Highlands in 2008 on Spring Watch. Very elusive, very shy creatures. But look at this. This was sent in by a viewer, and it's in 2013. But if we just highlight the back of that cat, and then highlight the one that we filmed back in 2008, look how incredible that is. It's the same, cat.
It's the same cat.
Because each wild cat has very distinctive markings. So it means that that cat, well, that was 6 years ago, it's probably at least 7.5 years old. So it's doing really well. But thank you very much for sending that footage in. It's great to see a wild cat.
Such an elusive animal. I've never seen one.